So I wrote to Corey, he sent me back, have 18 names of boys. I called Hillcrest, kind of, they're like, oh, yeah, that's kind of interesting. And they were going to help me, and then they decided no. And the Private Defenders Association didn't want to help either. But I thought, well, maybe these young boys had records as adults. So a lot of them did. So I started contacting their lawyers. And most people didn't call me back. This is thanks to Corey. Finally, one lawyer, I had a name of a boy who'd been in Hillcrest, and it was a very, very common name. If you go to sanmateocourt.org, there are about 18 names of the same the boy. So I was going through and calling the lawyers, and I come to about the last lawyer, and I just, I asked him, was this your client? And the lawyer wrote back, greetings, I am indeed a criminal attorney in San Mateo County, and I'm also familiar with Dr. Ayres and the charges against him. However, I do not remember representing a juvenile that was evaluated by Dr. Ayres. I only handled juvenile cases for a brief time. It was on Friday night, like, oh no. And I was so tired. I thought, well, maybe I'll just give it a last shot. So I wrote back, thanks for getting back to me. And since every single boy from Hillcrest on that list went on to have a record as adults, I imagine you have other adult clients who were seen by Ayres. If you're interested in helping, we would love it if the opportunity comes up to ask your criminal adult clients if they ever saw Ayres. The police are looking for people who saw him between 1988 to the present. And the lawyer writes back to me, I know someone who was treated by Dr. Ayres who told me he was molested by him when we were kids. I grew up in San Mateo. So through Corey, through this list, we found another victim.
We're talking about red flags and oversight. I think there's a relationship that needs oversight that's being overlooked. And I think it is the judge-psychiatrist relationship. When you're a psychotherapist, you are not allowed to have what's called a dual relationship with your client. That means you cannot be friends with them, you cannot do business with them, you cannot be in a personal relationship with them. That same dual relationship rule in law needs to apply for judges and the psychiatrists that they use. Number two, I believe that the amount of business that is sent to a psychiatrist or any psychotherapist, any vendor out there by a judge, needs to be limited in terms of the dollar amount.
Yes.
For two reasons. One is when certain vendors are being overutilized, they become very embedded in the system. They become part of the organization. That's what happened for Bill Ayres. Yeah. Secondly, if I'm one of those vendors, not Bill Ayres, but let's say I'm one of the vendors that's also used as much as Bill Ayres is, and I was getting $100,000 worth of business, let's say on an annual basis, I am less likely to come forward about Bill Ayres for fear of losing that income that I'm getting from the county. And that would make me hesitant. That would make me hesitant to report out a Bill Ayres in those circumstances. So I think that needs to be monitored as well.
Well, and with that same iceberg, I feel horrendously guilty that I referred kids to Bill Ayres. I mean, he was a very trusted and respected individual, and I believe was very helpful at the time. But his contract, which really was there, not when I was involved, he was the lowest bidder.
The county always goes.
It was the county. It was the county. The courts had someone to do it regularly. So he became much cheaper. Of course, he wasn't concerned about the $100,000. Well, there's a lot. A judge, I know Ayres was in friends with a particular juvenile judge here, and
there's no law that says you can't. I mean, there's nothing you can do about that.
That's just between us.
Just to my point, because I know that a lot of this is about what did or didn't happen and was culpable in the county, but I want to also bring it back to the fact that everybody in this room, every citizen out walking in the streets needs to step up, and that's where I brought the question of listening to children and what could we do or what kind of signs, so that it's not just about bashing what the county didn't do, but also what what everyone needs to do is step up to try to, you know, on both sides, make sure that we're listening to our children. And I like on here from Friends for Youth, it says that in 69% of youth-serving programs in San Mateo County, staff intuition can automatically disqualify a volunteer applicant. And that word intuition and acting on that intuition is so very important. And I don't know if we, you know, speak to...
Well, I think I wanted to get back to your question as to what parents and family members...
Well, again, it's different because it's maybe if it was school teacher, but a doctor, it's very intimidating, right? Because the doctor's there and it's like, oh, medical degrees and doctor, you know, they're gods. And so, but I have, you know, I thought I had 20 cases at least where this has happened before in the last 20 years, and there's lots more out there. I guess you've got a question. It's like, because I know parents said, oh, he's getting presents. That's strange. He's getting a physical. And just start asking questions. I know it's scary. I guess because you're already sending your kid to a therapist anyway, right? And the kid probably didn't want to go, so you probably feel bad about it. It's a very tricky situation. I'm sure he played on that too. And of course, he met all the parents, right? So he got a good... It's very difficult. But just go with your gut. And oh, I do want to say... Dr. Lynn Ponton, who's a child psychiatrist who evaluated Steve for the civil suit, reported him to the medical board. And before she did, she interviewed 20 psychiatrists, child psychiatrists around the country and asked them whether any of them had ever given physicals to kids, and none of them had. But the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry does not, as far as I know, have practice parameters. And I emailed them. I got some form thing back from them before I came here asking, well, do you have anything about, you know, child psychiatrists should get written permission from a parent? Should there, you know, be a nurse there? And, like, why would you even give a child a physical? But
you're saying give a physical. He was masturbating.
We know that, yes. Well, that's in quotes.
Guys are physical.
Yes, but they I think that's why Ayres and the, like, Dr. Don Wright, who was there, Judge Baker with them, that they were able to, well, I'm a doctor. I'm a medical doctor. That's what Ayres told Children's Services. I'm a doctor. And I think that the Dr. Lynn Ponton is meeting with the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry to discuss this issue, because they've got to have something in writing so the parents can say, no, this is not, you know,
aren't parents supposed to be informed of the scope?
Absolutely. But Ayres didn't, I mean, he had a tape made, a diagnostic interview that's for sale on the internet that he did in 1995. There's no mention of giving physicals to kids. This is what, anywhere. So parents, I hope the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry does something, but, just think presents. You know, what doctor gives a kid presents?
On the mandated reporting issue, what really are the consequences? You mentioned something about if you don't report and then it's traced back that you should have reported.
I'm not an expert in it. There's a Renee, you've heard a discussion more recently than I
have. Yeah, I'm actually also a mandated reporter trainer, and I can say we were talking at our CCAT meeting that unfortunately there's almost 0% charged.
It's a misdemeanor,
but there's almost
$1,000 fine.
It's
not accountability.
Yes, but they don't prosecute. So you can't lose your license. You can get a fine. You can, but they do not prosecute.
And just as an evidentiary aspect, it's difficult. The statute doesn't define what a suspicion is.
Right.
But the remarkable thing is you're protected if you report.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. You know, if you make a mistake and you report, you're okay.
Yeah. So why didn't they report him?
Because of the kinds of consequences that
Jeff was talking about.
I think we all have a natural tendency to want to protect people that are close to us, whether it's a family member or a colleague. And I think you have to remember, if you're in that situation, that this is very much a compulsive type of behavior. It's not going to stop unless it's exposed.
Yeah. Right.
They may not stop.